November 14th, let us trust in God, then, but trust Him without limits. Let us trust in God then, but trust Him without limits. That is Saint Maximilian Kolbe. Oh, we're quoting him a lot lately. For as much as we try to have faith in the Lord, there are times when we give to God with one hand and take back with the other. The father of a son possessed by a demon in the Gospel of Mark says, I do believe, help my unbelief. As much as possible, we have to surrender our doubts and hesitancy and place our trust entirely on the Lord. Lord, you are my rock. You are my fortress. You are my all. No, I wasn't going to do a sermon or anything, but this does make me think of another passage. So there is that, the passage it alludes to, or that it references, Jesus actually comes down the mountain. He just had been transfigured in front of some of his disciples. He changed his appearance, and Moses and Elijah were there, and it was this big event that happened to, you know, three of his disciples got to see. And as he comes down, there's this crowd, and this boy is possessed by a demon, and there's a crowd around, and the other disciples are trying to cast this demon out, but he won't leave, and the father runs up to Jesus and says, help my son, and Jesus says, what's going on? And he explains, and then the father says, cast him out if you can, something like that. And Jesus says, if I can. Everything is possible to the one who believes, or everything is possible to the one who has faith. And the guy says, the man says, I do believe. Help my unbelief. So I do believe, but help me get rid of the part that doesn't believe, right? It's like, there's a poet named Rumi, he's Muslim, and he wrote back in the 13th or 14th century, your job is not to find love, but to remove everything within you that blocks love from you. The love is already here, right? Just like your job is not to find God. God is already here. God is in the midst of all things. We don't have to do anything. I say this all the time. You've heard me say this before. We don't have to do anything to enter into God's presence. God is present right here with me, with you, with whatever. God is present right now. So we don't have to do anything to enter into God's presence. We just have to remove the things in our lives and the things in ourselves that block that presence from us. It's like the sun is always shining. Even at night when we can't see the sun is always shining. Well, why do we not see the sun at night? Because it is blocked. It's on the other side of the earth, so we're blocked by the earth. So we don't see the sun shining, but the sun is always there, and it's always shining. Just like in a solar eclipse, the sun continues to shine. It's just that the moon gets in the way for a few minutes, so it blocks the light. So your job isn't to make the sun shine or find the shining sun. It is to remove everything that blocks the light of the sun from shining on you, right? That's the analogy to your job isn't to find God. Your job isn't to find love. Your job isn't to find faith. It is to remove all the things that block the faith from you, even those things within yourself. Even if those things within yourself are your attitude, your limiting ideas, your worldview, if they get in the way of your faith, if they get in the way of your God, if they get in the way of your happiness, your job isn't to find happiness. Happiness is here. It's to remove all the stuff that blocks that happiness from you, internal as well as external. So if your job is getting in the way of God, and I'm not telling you to leave your job, but you may want to think about finding a new job. If your job gets in the way of God or your happiness, or your faith, then, and those things are important to you, then maybe your job, you need to find a new job. I'm not saying quit your job. Don't hear me say that. I'm saying if these things are blocking your happiness, blocking your faith, blocking your relationship with God, something has to change if you want to have that happiness and faith and relationship with God. So either you have to find a way to change your job, or end your job, or whatever. But I'm not telling you to go on unemployment or quit your job or anything like that. I'm just saying whatever blocks God from us, we must block. We must remove, right? Because these things are... And that's sort of what sin does, too, by the way. This is what sin is. Sin is a blocker. So we think of sin, especially in the West, as this sort of breaking of a law, right? There's this rule, and we break it, and we're bad. But sin is more of, there's the light of God shining on us, and sin creates a barrier. And then the light of God can't shine on us because we have this barrier between us and God. So, we must confess our sins and be forgiven of our sins, and the sin goes away, and that light of God continues to shine on us again. Hopefully that makes sense. But I didn't want to say any of that. I wanted to say this. because where it says, if I can just find it again. As much as possible, we have to surrender our doubt and our hesitancy and place our trust entirely in the Lord. Jesus says, and it's after he withers a fig tree, and this is also Mark. This is Mark chapter 11, beginning of verse 22. So this fig tree doesn't give fruit. Jesus says, you're never going to get fruit again. The fig tree withers. And the disciples notices, and Peter says, Rabbi, look, the fig tree that you cursed is withered. And Jesus says to him, have faith in God. Truly I tell you, if anyone says to this mountain, be lifted up and thrown into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes what he says will happen, it will be done for him. If anyone says to this mountain, be lifted up and thrown into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes what he says will happen, it will be done for him. Therefore, I tell you, I being Jesus, therefore I, Jesus, tell you, everything you pray and ask for, believe you have received it, and it will be yours. And whenever you stand praying, if you have anything against anyone, forgive him or her, so that your Father in heaven will also forgive you your wrongdoing. Every time Jesus teaches prayer, by the way, not every time, but pretty much every time I can think of, so say most of the time when Jesus teaches about prayer, he always concludes it with teaching about forgiveness and reminding you that if you don't forgive others, you will not be forgiven. So unforgiveness, in my mind, based on the fact that every time Jesus, when Jesus teaches the Lord's Prayer, by the way, he ends it by talking about forgiveness. If you don't forgive others, then your Father in heaven will not forgive you. Well, for unforgiveness is another one of those blockers that blocks faith, blocks our prayers from happening. So Jesus is talking about whenever you, whatever you want in prayer, whatever you ask God for in prayer, whatever your prayer is, believe you have received it. Believe like you already have it. You know, and make sure you're praying for good. I mean, I'm praying for Alexis or something like that. All right, maybe not. But, you know, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that it has happened. And start acting as if it's happened, whether it's happened or not. Like if you're praying for health, and I'm not saying don't go to the doctor, don't have people start send me a message, I'm telling people not to go to the doctor. I believe, I work in the medical field, so I'm big on doctors and medicine and things like that. But if you're praying for healing, you know, the doctors and medicines, that prayer and faith assist in our healing as well as medicine and other things. So if you're praying for healing, this is one thing I can never teach my mom, because my mom was always praying for healing. I would anoint her for healing. She'd always ask for prayers for healing. And then the second I anointed her, or the second we prayed for healing, and she, even if she claimed, I'm healed, and all that stuff, in Jesus' name, the second she was done, she would start talking about how sick she is. And so, if I believe that I am healed, when I ask God to heal me, for instance, and I believe that I am healed, he says, whatever you ask for, believe you have received it. So if I believe I've received healing, I can't keep talking about being sick. And I know it sounds absurd, because if I'm still in pain or sick or whatever, how can I talk about I'm healed? So I learned to say something like, hey, I may not look healed, I may not feel healed, but my feelings aren't facts. So I can't go by what I feel. If I base my faith on what I feel, I'm going to believe something different every day. So I may not look healed, I may not feel healed, but in the name of Jesus, I am healed. And I want to keep saying I'm healed until my body gets in line with the Word of God and is healed. Until my body gets in line with my faith, which is healed. Because the one who believes, everything is possible to the one who believes. Everything. Jesus doesn't qualify that, by the way. He doesn't say everything, oh, except your healing. Everything, oh, except your finances. Everything except your addiction to drugs or alcohol. He doesn't qualify it. He says everything is possible to the one who believes. So if you want to quit drugs and alcohol, for instance, and you believe it's possible, and you ask God to help you quit, to remove the desire to use drug and alcohol, or whatever it is you want to do, I mean, I recommend going to a 12-step program. But they'll still tell you you're relying on God to keep you sober, to keep you clean that day. No willpower is going to do it. If your willpower could work, you would have worked it a long time ago. So the willpower doesn't work. Only our faith in the higher power works for that. And so if you have faith, even your sobriety or your being clean from drugs is possible, if that's what you want. So you ask, God, keep me sober today, and then I believe God is keeping me sober today. I believe it. Then I don't have to worry. It's off the table now. I don't have to worry about using. I don't have to worry about, oh, what happens in this situation, that situation. I ask God, I believe I received it. Therefore, even if I'm walking to a situation where someone throws a drink in my face, I'm not going to drink it, because I ask God to keep me sober, and I believe God's going to keep me sober, and therefore that drink is not going to get in my body. Regardless, if someone tries to pour it down my throat, something's going to stop it. Ooh, I'm in a preachy mood. And I don't know if this sounds absurd or like nonsense to anybody, and I don't know if somebody needs to hear this. I don't know if I'm just preaching to myself right now, because I need to hear it. I don't know. But all things are possible to the one who believes. And I know it sounds absurd, because there's a lot of crazy things, and how can, you know. So I'll conclude on this. I'll conclude all this, because I don't even have a point for any of this, other than apparently I or somebody needs to hear me say it. So I'll conclude on this story. And I actually told this story the other night to some friends. Years ago, I was going, we're going back a long time, like 10, 15 years ago, maybe. I was going through some stuff, and life was tough. Life was really lifey. And it wasn't a conversation that happened to me, but I got to overhear this conversation of two other people. One guy was going through some stuff. And I overheard the part where it was the guy saying, this, and this is bad, and I don't know how I'm going to get through this, and I'm trying to get through this, and, you know, and the other guy says, well, you just got to give that to God. Let God handle that for you. You know, just pray and give it to God and let God handle it. Which, on one hand, sounds like great advice, but on the other hand, when you're the one going through the troubles, that's, come on, give me something better. I need some practical steps, right? Well, the practical step is give it to God and let God handle it. And the guy said, the other guy, the first guy who was complaining about all the stuff, his response to give it to God was, well, I don't see how God is going to be able to handle, you know, fix any of this. To which the second man said, well, if God can't handle it, if God can't fix it, why do you think you can? And I don't know if that first guy got it, but I got it when I heard that. If God can't fix it, if God can't handle it, if God can't resolve the situation, why do I think that I'm going to be the one to fix it or resolve it? That my willpower and my worry and my stress is somehow going to fix this situation that I decided that God can't fix. Whereas I am told in Scripture by Jesus himself, and I don't know, Jesus is kind of important, right? I'm told in Scripture what that other guy said to his friend who was going through all this stuff. All things are possible to the one who believes. Give it to God. Ask God to get you through it and believe God is getting you through it. And you'll get through it somehow. It may not be in the way you think you'll get through it. It may not be in the way you think you want to get through it, but you will get through it, and you will get through it in a way when you look back and say, wow, I would have really sold myself short if I got what I wanted instead of I got what was best for me, right?